agree to it. And I also welcome Dr. Shanta sir. Arif sir, he is a very prominent pediatrician of Kota, and he runs a very beautiful managed pediatric hospital. And it's a group of pediatricians who run that hospital with a very unique concept. And a great academician, always there in all the IAP activities centrally as well as from Rajasthan level, has presented many a times as speaker in the national conferences and done himself a pedicon in Kota. So I welcome my chairpersons. RK sir is my teacher, my colleague, my friend, and I don't have any words to say about. So Sanjeev, kindly take the program and start the proceedings. Thank you very much.
Thank you Manish sir, our secretary. Now I would like to request our chairperson VM Rathudi sir to introduce, formally introduce our speaker.
Thank you Sanjeev. I Dr. Arif Ahmed sahab ka Jaipur IAP ki taraf se istiqbal karta hu.
Namaskar. Sir, aapki awaaz nahi aa rahi sir. Sir, awaaz nahi aa rahi.
Could you hear me?
Yeah. Ashok Sada sir. Namaskar sir. Namaskar sir.
Awaaz nahi aa rahi.
आवाज बहुत कम आ रही है सर.
सर नाउ ऑडिबल.
मैं डॉक्टर.
अब आ रही है.
हेलो, नाउ वॉइस इज देयर.
यस,
मैं थोड़ा सा अहमद साहब का.
अब आ रही है आवाज.
अशोक सर आपकी आवाज आ रही है.
अशोक सर आपकी आ रही है. रतुड़ी सर की कम आ रही है.
थैंक यू मनीष फॉर द काइंड वर्ड्स. It's my pride privilege to introduce dignitary.
Ashok sir, Dr. Rathudi sir is speaking. Yes, kindly wait for him to finish his.
Okay. Thank you.
Dr. Ashok, you can join me to Jaipur IAP ki taraf se Dr. Arif Ahmed sahab ka istiqbal karta hu. Aur Dr. RK Gupta sahab ne waise aapka bahut acha introduction de diya hai. एक जयपुर मैं सब आपको सब जानते हैं, आपकी किताबें आपके. मैं डॉक्टर अशोक शारदा से रिक्वेस्ट करूंगा कि वो उनको आप बताएं इनके बारे में.
शारदा सर प्लीज. शारदा सर
सर
अनम्यूट करें प्लीज. शारदा सर अनम्यूट करें प्लीज. सर यू. हाँ यस सर,
आवाज आ रही है.
यस सर, यस सर,
बोले
सर. थैंक यू मनीष फॉर द काइंड वर्ड्स एंड डॉक्टर संजीव फॉर इन्वॉल्विंग अस इन दिस वेबिनार. वी हैव अ वेरी एमिनेंट नेशनल फैकल्टी एंड इंटरनेशनल रिप्यूट पर्सन विद अस डॉक्टर आरिफ मोहम्मद. इट्स माय प्राइड प्रिविलेज टू इंट्रोड्यूस हिम. ही हैड बीन author for the winning energies, a very famous book, Myths and Beliefs, and which is published by the Hay House of Publication. He had been trained at Royal Manchester Children Hospital in UK, European board. He got a European board certificate, EACCI, European Academy of Allergy and Immunology, and he had been professor at Shadan Medical College, Hyderabad, director of allergy center for the chest diseases in the Hyderabad, and he had so many publications on allergy and in international and national journals and the conference in US and Europe, and delivered more than 150 lectures on allergy across the India and internationally. And he had been past national convener for IAP, ALS, PALS course, and national coordinator for basic life support courses. So it's our pride privilege to hear him today. And we are really having a very good time with Dr. Arif Ahmed. And I request him to please start his talk.
Over to Dr. Arif, sir, please.
आपका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद शारदा साहब और रतुड़ी साहब की जो आपने मुझे ना आपके इंट्रोडक्शन के लिए. एंड आई एम रियली थैंकफुल टू आईआईपी जयपुर. आई हैव अ वेरी क्लोज कनेक्शन विद आईआईपी जयपुर. योर कैंडिडेट टुडे डॉक्टर तरुण पाटनी इज लाइक इज माय अनुज और व्हाट यू से इज यंगर ब्रदर. आई हैव ट्रेवल्ड ऑल ओवर राजस्थान गिविंग दीज लेक्चर्स ऑन एलर्जी, सो एवरीबॉडी इज वेरी फेमिलियर विथ मी. And so among these 150 places, Jaipur and Jodhpur and Ajmer are the different places that I have been to. And the very important thing is, Dr. Sharda, I was, if you don't remember, I don't know where I first met you in the Delhi Pedicon. Okay, and I think you are getting an FIAP at that time. So I just, am I right?
Yes.
Yes, okay, good. So I'm glad you remember that. Okay, so I had a brief talk with you at that time. Anyway, my lecture on winning over allergies, I start off this now. I share the screen. Okay. So the whole thing is, this is the introduction. Why is it not moving? Slide is... Again, I'll share screen.
Sir, I will share.
No, no, no. One minute. Yes. Because... Okay. Can I not get a full, share screen. Okay.
It's okay now.
Yeah, it's newer modalities in the management of allergies. I assume that most of you all have been exposed to lectures on allergies and all. So we can talk, and you all know the basic of allergies as how to make a diagnosis and all. So I'll go a little bit beyond. First, we'll talk about investigation, some basic treatment. And the third part of my lecture will be on food allergies, the newer types of food allergies, which you have to start thinking about. Okay. So let's start. Now, ye kyun nahi move ho raha hai? Okay. Yeah. So this is what I'll be talking about first: investigation, newer treatment, which are the immunomodulators, immunotherapy, omalizumab. Then I'll talk about food allergies. Insect bites we won't get into because it's, we won't have time for that. So let's start with the investigations. Okay, now we have this case. Ashna, a 12-year-old female, presents at age 9 years. At birth, it was strict breastfeeding. Then at 5 months, they developed the rash, the typical type, the pustular rash, with and improved with moisturizers. And with steroid, there was complete remission. At 11 months, there were formula feeds, reacted badly, swelling of extremities and worsening of the rashes, diagnosed as milk allergy and then taken off it. And over the year, the eczema, which was came up at 5 months, was waxing and waning, but it never disappeared. At 4 years, started wheezing. At 8 years, along with the wheezing, okay, there were these nasal symptoms. And at 9 years, when I saw this child, there was this atopic dermatitis, the rash was there, the nasal symptoms were there. The wheezing was there and the eyes were completely red and congested. So this child has basically followed what we call as the atopic or the allergic march. The diagnosis is very clear to everybody. Is allergic rhinoconjunctivitis with asthma, with severe eczema, with food allergy. Now, I do all these tests, okay? All these tests were done. Now, okay. So the question is, how do you interpret these results? You know, this is a very common thing. Patient comes to you, you make a diagnosis and you get the blood test done for the food items as well as for the aeroallergens. Now, in the aeroallergens is a very reliable thing. Okay, so all these, this child which he had, we did good environmental exposure and the respiratory problems came down. Now you see out here, the values of different food items. Okay, this is a very common thing which the pediatrician faces when they have a blood test and you have all these results which are positive. Now, what is the normal value? Is less than 0.10. And you see that all these food items are raised. Okay, now the pediatrician asks me, you'll ask, now what do I do? Normally, what you do is you will stop all of them. Now, listen very carefully. How do you interpret these high values? First thing you see out here is that the total IG is more than 30,000, where the normal value is less than 64. So because of the severe eczema, the whole body is abraded. All the allergens can walk through. They can walk through the nose, through the lungs, and through the skin. That is why the total IG is raised. So if the total IG is raised, all the specific IG for different food items will automatically get raised. So now the question arises, which food item should I stop and which food item should I continue? Anything which is more than 100, okay, yeah, milk is more than 100, stop it. All right, next is what, peanut. More than 100, stop it. What about the other values? If the child, irrespective of the value, if the child is eating that food item freely with no problems, continue it. Here the wheat, if you look at it, is 45. But the child was tolerating wheat very well, while the egg is 39. But the child did not tolerate the egg well. While the fish, which is increased, soya bean, walnut, all are increased. But the child was tolerating this food well. So the message to put across is, any food item, if the child is tolerating, despite of the positive results on this on the blood test, continue that food item. Please do not stop it. Because clinical reactivity is much more important than what comes in the blood test. Okay, so we'll get on to the next case. All right, if there. Now the same case, okay, that is Ashna, okay, which is 12 years, and I've presented the history, and this is the diagnosis. Now this is the report which you have seen earlier. Okay, now let's look at only one part of the treatment I'm going to go into. That is the severe eczema. Okay, now how do you treat the severe eczema? Now you all know about the basic management. That is the moisturizer, which is the basic management. And when there are flares, what do you do is you give steroids only to decrease the flare for a short duration of time, maybe 10 to 15 to 20 days, not more than that. Now there's a newer treatment, what we call as the immunomodulators. That is pimecrolimus and tacrolimus. They are immunomodulators. Now, a word about immunomodulators. When do you apply the immunomodulators? You apply the immunomodulators only when you have controlled the flare with the steroids. After the flares have been controlled, then on those susceptible parts, whether they really occur, that is the flexural surfaces and the neck surfaces, you apply them over there after a 15 to 20 day course of steroid. And for how long do you apply? Minimum 6 months. Maximum how much? 5 years. When do you start applying? Only after the age of 2 years. Some people go to as less as 6 months in a very severe case, but you also can start tacrolimus or pimecrolimus after the age of 2 years and give it for a minimum 6 months. Any side effects? Known, not any known side effects and all. It's a very safe drug, much more safer than your steroids. Which one do you choose between the two, pimecrolimus or tacrolimus? Pimecrolimus is quite costly, so you go for tacrolimus, which is available, freely available, and is a cheaper drug as compared to pimecrolimus. It's an immunomodulator, and in severe type of eczemas, you should and you can use it. Okay, I will not get into the basic management. Okay, the next case. Okay, you have seen this child, is a 14-year-old child, severe sneezing, okay? Now, constant sneezing was there, especially at nighttime, and this was lasting for a month. They came to me like this. So, what did I see? There was a blocked nose, sleep and daily activity was totally disturbed, and obviously I make a diagnosis of allergic rhinitis, moderate, severe, persistent. I do a skin prick test, which is positive for dust mites. But in spite of all the treatment which I gave, which you can think of, which you know, intranasal steroids, intranasal antihistaminics, oral antihistaminics, oral montelukast, everything was given, but this was the condition of the child. I wanted to give oral steroid. The patient said, no, we have been given enough courses of oral steroid by other doctors. We do not want oral steroids. Okay, anyway, I went into the history further. There was this history of constant headache 2 years back, which lasted for a year. And the child was treated as migraine by the neurologist, since mom was also migraine. I did the review of the CT scan, which was done 2 years back for that headache. And that CT scan itself shows maxillary sinusitis with nasal polyp. That means there was a significant amount of allergic rhinitis, rhinosinusitis with the polyp formation. And this child was not responding to our treatment. In spite of all the treatment that you think of, this was the response which you have seen in the video. So what I did was, this was a patient of mine in Mumbai where I do monthly consultation. They lived in the upper class area. Allergic rhinitis is a disease more of the upper class, of the wealthy people. It's not so common in the lower classes, where you have an increased standard of living, okay? So that house was a typical upper class house, fully upholstered and all that. Now, what had happened in the last 1 year? In the last 1 year, this patient, you know, stayed on the seventh floor. A building had come up behind the bedroom. The window, the bedroom was west facing. So what did this building do to this disease? Two important things. One is the building, the coming of the building blocked the sun. The sun is the biggest killer of dust mites that everybody should know. The sun is the biggest enemy of dust mites. Two, this construction, they release a particulate matter. Particulate matter by itself is not so dangerous. Dust mite itself also may not be so dangerous. But when the two combine, they have a synergistic effect. So that's what we did. We shifted this patient out from the site, okay, to the different room. And we had to redo the whole house so that it was more environmental friendly, free of the environmental allergens. The other thing is also, this child had a psychological impact also of the disease. And we brought about psychological disturbances. Which had to be corrected. So the take-home message is, whatever, however much your treatment, the basic thing about allergic rhinitis is, first and foremost important is patient education. They have to, once you have made a diagnosis, you should tell them what the disease is. Because there is a chronic disease, they're going to live for a long time. Okay, so please tell them what the whole disease is. Next is pharmacotherapy. It's very easy for you to write a prescription. You know, you have learned Nasonex and steroid spray and oral histamine. But you have to teach them how to use these sprays and all. It's very important. And once these two things have been done, you look at the allergen avoidance. And in this case, allergen avoidance was very important. We did the allergen avoidance. And after that, the patient improved. But when you want a complete cure, you need to go for the fourth pillar, and that is the immunotherapy. And this is the area of the allergist. But the first two pillars are the areas of every pediatrician. The third pillar is shared between the allergist and the clinician. What is my role? To diagnose what the cause is. Once we have diagnosed the cause, in this case with dust mites, it is the job of the clinician now to manage that patient completely. And if it is not being if it's a severe type, as in this case, then you need to go for immunotherapy, and that's where we deal. So just to let you know what is immunotherapy, it is of two types, subcutaneous or sublingual. Okay, both have to be given for 3 years. And in this case, this patient Yash was given sublingual. Okay, and he is completely and absolutely normal now. Now, which one to choose? See, SCIT, the injection one. And both are the same cost effectiveness. Safety-wise, the injection has a, there's a rare chance of an anaphylaxis, while in this slit, there's no chance of anaphylaxis. But while WHO says that slit and skit are equally efficacious, but we in practice have found to be the injection to be more efficacious than the sublingual drops. So in short, you can go for any one which you can choose for. You can advise any one of them, but it's always better under the guidance of a allergist. Okay, any one you can choose for after the age of 5 years. Now, this is the fourth case. Okay, now 23-year-old female, because this treatment has not been used by me in pediatric age group. So it was used in a 23-year-old patient which came with chronic urticaria. We did the specific IG for dust mites, which were positive. there was no response to dust mite avoidance. Now, I want to tell you this. Patients of acute urticaria, in 50%, you may find a cause. In chronic urticaria, allergy as a cause is very, very, very uncommon. Less than 10% chance. Many of them get dust mite positive. Stopping dust mites has no impact on these patients of chronic urticaria. Now, what is the treatment for chronic urticaria? You give oral antihistaminics, second generation. Okay, you start with a single dose. If that doesn't respond, you can go to four times the dose. So in this case, we gave bilastine 20 mg, a single tablet. No response, we went to four tablets in a day. But what happened when we stopped, it came back. So this patient improved with subcutaneous omalizumab. Omalizumab is used beyond 12 years of age, okay, and it has shown a very good response. So this is the treatment of urticaria. The first is the second generation antihistaminics, which you use bilastine. You can use your fexofenadine, either one of the two, or cetirizine. If that doesn't improve, go to four times the dose. Even if that is not responding, then you have to go for omalizumab. Montelukast has no effect. Now, steroids, only a short-term course of, in a severe case, acute onset urticaria, 4 to 5 days. There is no role of giving 2 weeks and 3 weeks and all. It doesn't help. You just go on increasing the dose of the antihistaminics. So this is what, in this point, I want to introduce about omalizumab. Okay, so before I go on to the food allergies, if there are any questions, I would ask the chairperson to put up any questions. Or I go on to food allergies.
Then no... Yes, Nis, sir, you can go and then we will ask the question on later.
Okay.
Go ahead, sir.
Yeah. So you see now the food, every, you know about food allergy, but the whole question is, there's so many misconceptions about food allergies. So now today I'm trying to about clear these misconceptions about food allergies, trying to give a case presentation of different types of food intolerance, okay, or food adverse effects. So we have this 2-month-old boy, exclusively was breastfed, given supplemental bottle of cow's milk formula. 4 hours later, developed profuse vomiting and diarrhea, lethargy, and sepsis-like picture taken to ER. Which diagnosis should be considered? Now, it has been all throughout, if you were to do this, you'd be making a diagnosis of sepsis. I am sure everybody will agree because of the sepsis-like picture. Intussusception also, they would think, because formulas can has a predisposition. Volvulus also is possible, okay? I would not discount the first, second, and third possibilities where you can consider that the bottle of milk, cow's milk formula, is a red herring, okay? Okay, so not to be carried away. And your first three are possible. But from now onwards, you should think of the fourth diagnosis known as acute food protein-induced enterocolitis, F-PIES you call it. Okay, the F-PIES is a condition which is occurred because of formula milk, cow's milk, or it can occur because of any food item which is introduced in the infant. Okay, and a very important thing is that it can present with a shock-like picture. I'll come to that later. More details about that later. Now, we had this child, 2-month-old boy. He presented to the ER. It was failure to thrive. There was abdominal distension. There was tachypnea, and there was moderate dehydration. Week ago, he had diarrhea. The child was irritable with blood in stools, changed to 0 lac. Symptoms did not improve. So pediatrician changed. You know, you go on changing from one formula to another, but no improvement. Diarrhea, on the contrary, deteriorated. Now was metabolic acidosis with bicarb low and base excess. Abnormal electrolytes, hypokalemia, WBC is okay, slightly raised, but hemoglobin is low. But the clinching thing out here was there was this erythematous patch on the neck, trunk, and around mouth. When there's a rash, you think of an allergy, okay? And in this case, because of the introduction of this milk and the rash, we thought about cow's milk protein allergy. So this is, you may be aware of it, but start thinking about cow's milk protein allergy when there's a change in the formula, or when you're introducing, formula milk, and especially when it is associated with rash. Okay, now to differentiate further, let's get on to the other types. No, this is yesterday only, just last week only I saw such a type of baby. 2-month-old baby. The present baby is 4 months actually. So baby was breastfed and bloody stool. Now this baby was having loose motion for 5 to 6, 7, 8, 10 days. You did the culture, negative, stool test, negative. You change reducing substance, pH, everything normal. Baby absolutely healthy. Okay. So what, aside from this, there was nothing. So what we found it was more of fresh blood. The diagnosis, what would be the diagnosis in this case? It would be food protein induced allergic proctocolitis. All you have to do is to stop the milk and give your Neo Kit or what you call hydrolyzed milk formula. That's what had to be given, and this baby was fine after giving the hydrolyzed milk formula. Now this next baby, 9-month-old baby, present with recurrent vomiting. Diarrhea was there, failure to thrive was there, there was malabsorption and anemia, negative cilia screen. But the most important thing was the endoscopic finding was villus atrophy. So in this case, the diagnosis would be food protein enteropathy. In FPIs, chronic FPIs can have a similar picture, but the biopsy will be normal, absolutely normal. So since there was villus atrophy, the diagnosis would be food protein enteropathy. It could be because of wheat, or it could be any other food item. Okay, so now you know what is FPIAP, what is FPIs, and food protein enteropathy. So let's get on to what is this FPIs. We had this baby, 6-month-old Rahul, previously well, breastfed, vomited 3 hours after the first formula feed, no other symptoms, settled spontaneously by next day. You thought of gastroenteritis, you continued with the breastfeeding. You tried again with the bottle 1 month later, and after 2 hours, there was profuse vomiting, pale, floppy baby, shocked, no rash, sepsis-like picture. He was taken to the ER, no response to iron meddling, and improved with IV fluids. So which diagnosis should be considered? Sepsis? No, I would not consider sepsis because this has recurred. Sepsis won't recur like this. Volvulus? No. Okay, food poisoning, you can't get in such a small recurrent at this age. And GRD also, you'll agree with is no. So the diagnosis is FPIs, okay? Food protein induced enteropathy. Somebody would ask me, why can't it not be milk allergy? Okay, SPT and IG to milk were negative, but this was done later. But at that stage, can you think of milk allergy? Yes, you can think of milk allergy. And that's why the IM adrenaline was given and there was no response. If it would have been milk allergy, the child would have responded dramatically to your IM adrenaline, okay? So that is why it is not milk allergy. It is FPIs. In FPIs, IgE to milk is negative, while in cow's milk allergy, IgE is positive, okay? So this FPIs is in the indoor pedicon. I had a 20-minute lecture on FPIs. Is a new condition, is a condition which you should know, which is when you introduce a formula milk or cow's milk, or you start weaning off on rice, grains, or non-veg, you will get this sudden episodes of vomitings and diarrhea. Unlike milk allergy or food allergy, which occurs immediately, this will occur 1 to 4 hours after the feed. Okay, and it can sometimes lead to a shock-like picture. And adrenaline doesn't work. All you have to do is to give push-in fluids. Okay, you have to avoid that particular food item up to the age of 2 years. You can re-challenge and the child gradually grows off it. So this is the acute treatment. The treatment is extensively hydrolyzed formula rather than amino acid formula. And at 2 years, you retry food in the hospital. Now this is the final case. Do I have time? How much time do I have?
No, sir, you have 10-15 minutes
more. Okay. Now this is a final case. Now, when I was working in UK way back in 2011, I saw this case. Now there's a mistake. This is not a 3-year-old girl. This is a 13-year-old girl with known peanut allergy and asthma since 2.5 years of age. Skin prick test for the peanuts was positive. EpiPen was prescribed and the child was carrying EpiPen. I'll show you a picture. But never used it. And then afterwards, the child was lost to it. And I think all of you should know this case because I remember in the Jaipur Pedicon, one famous pediatrician neonatologist from Delhi had an episode of peanut allergy and had peanut anaphylaxis in the lunchtime, and nobody knew what to do. So at least now after this one, you'll understand the importance of this of knowing about this case. There was a mild reaction to peanut at 5 years of age, and no treatment was given, okay? And it recovered by itself. Now on 24th of 26th August, that is when the child is 13 years old, in 2011, the child was on a holiday, ate chicken tikka masala, was eaten in an English pub. So went on a holiday, ate chicken tikka masala, and came back from the holiday. Okay, so at 4 o'clock they come, at 9 o'clock, there was a party at friend's house, attended with mom. What the mom's chicken tikka masala was now ordered from an Indian takeaway, okay? And she said, oh, don't worry, mom, nothing will happen. I ate a chicken tikka masala in Wales and nothing happened to me. And so the chicken tikka masala from an Indian takeaway was ordered. Food was delivered, and within 15 minutes of eating the food, she felt a tingling sensation, swollen legs with signs of breathlessness. But at that time, that EpiPen was not with her. So the mom gave an antihistaminic tablet, salbutamol inhaler, and these two were given. The 999 was called. The ambulance arrived. Normally, this is what is the EpiPen, and this is how it is given. Okay, like it is shot into the thigh on the side. Now, this adrenaline driver, the ambulance driver gave adrenaline 0.5 mg in the deltoid, and the ambulance crew felt that it is anaphylaxis. They gave nebulized salbutamol, IV chlorpheniramine. They repeated the adrenaline. Adrenaline can be repeated every 15 minutes or at least three times. And they took the child to the hospital. Now, in the hospital, the child was admitted in the casualty, fully conscious. There were the swollen lips and tongue was there. Saturations were normal on 10 liters of oxygen. And all the parameters were normal. The child was given hydrocortisone, salbutamol. At 11:30, again, adrenaline was given IM. Further improvement was there clinically and referred to the pediatric team for admission. Now we have almost 1 hour 45 minutes has been passed and seen by pediatric team, comfortable, good air entry, extensive wheezing. All the parameter investigations are normal. The child is there now 2 hours later, laughing, chatting, joking with everybody, okay? But the saturations are 100%, but on 10 liters of oxygen, and all the vitals are normal. And suddenly after that, there was an episode of breathlessness, felt warm, irritable, lips and tongue started swelling again, throat pain, can't breathe, adrenaline given IM. The entire team in a tertiary care hospital is called. There's further deterioration, saturations are falling, and this child collapses with a big vomit. The anesthetist intubates it. There's some improvement in saturations. But over the next 10, 15 minutes, with all the possibility which you can see on the screen out there, and Dr. Manish Sharma also is there to look at it and watch for it, was given. Nothing was left that which could not be given in a tertiary care center. And in spite of all the best measures, the CPR was declared unsuccessful. Okay, and the patient, a PM was done, and the lips and tongue swelling, prominent laryngeal edema, mucus plugging of the small airways with prominent edema and eosinophilic infiltration. All right. Now, chicken tikka masala contained mixed nuts, 90% peanuts and 10% almond. This is very important from where you order the food. In Indian restaurant, they marinate it with peanuts, unlike in English restaurants where they do not marinate with peanuts. And they may not be using many of the... So it is very important. The same thing can be prepared by different ways in different restaurants. Now, here the important thing which I want to point out is this MCT. What is MCT? MCT is tryptase level, okay? This is a new investigation. The diagnosis of anaphylaxis is classically clinical, but tryptase will help you if the tryptase is elevated, which is the costly test, costs 5,000 to 6,000 rupees. If it is collected within 1 to 6 hours of the test, and if the tryptase is elevated, then you can say there was anaphylaxis. But it is also not so reliable in case where the allergen enters through the oral route. If the allergen enters by the intramuscular, like a bite or an injection. So if you have a patient of say a drug anaphylaxis in an injection leading to anaphylaxis, immediately collect the blood for tryptase level after 1 hour, okay, and you send it for analysis. If the tryptase is not raised, then that was not anaphylaxis. This is a very good way of diagnosing anaphylaxis in your clinic by doing tryptase level for suspected patients of injectable anaphylaxis, whether insect bite or your drug. Okay, so that is what I wanted to point out. The other important thing out here is that we have to know is that a patient who develops anaphylaxis because secondary to food allergy should be kept in hospital for at least 8 hours. And at the end of 8 hours, they're absolutely normal and they become normal immediately after a shot of adrenaline. Okay, so but still keep them at least 8 hours if possible for at least 24 hours. So with this case, I end my discussion. Okay, now before that, I would like to know bring about that the importance of food allergy. Food allergy is why you should know about it, because this is how it has been changing in the entire world. In the 90s, this is the picture of the Western world, Australia, where in the 60s, the respiratory allergies was very low. And with the increase, and they gradually increased over the next 20 years. And in the 1980s, there was a plateau because of the increased use of inhalation therapy. And after 20 year lag, on the beginning of this century, 21st century, there has been a steady increase in food allergy and eczema. Okay. Now we are almost 20 to 30 years behind the West. We do not have this epidemic of eczema and food allergy, but it is only a matter of time now because of increased environmental changes, increasing food habit changes, we are going to see an epidemic of eczema and food allergies. So be prepared for it. Try to pick them up, okay? So that is the whole purpose of this lecture, creating an awareness about the wide prevalence of allergy, creating a knowledge about allergy, creating a basic understanding about allergy, need for proper diagnosis, factors contributing, and environmental, both your food environment and the aeroallergen environment. And that is why I've come up with this book, Winning Over Allergies, Myths and Facts. It's for both doctors as well as for patients, okay? And it's a very easy to read and it covers all aspects. This is the book. It is available on Amazon, okay? And you can go to any of these bookstores like Crossword and all. It will be available there also. So I would recommend everyone to go through it. It's very light reading because allergy is one topic which you have not studied at undergraduate or postgraduate level. So just to get a basic understanding, this book will really help you. So if you want to know more about this book, you can go on to my website. This is www.lme.com. And I have given excerpts about from this book on this website. You can go through that to create some excitement. And with these words, I thank you and I thank IIP Jaipur. I thank our host. I thank our chairperson. I thank Dr. Gupta and both Sanjeev Gupta, MK Gupta and Dr. Sharma. Thank you all and over to you.
Thank you, sir, for a nice and lucid presentation. Before going to further, I would like to request our all the participants, please put your question on chat box. And it is our high privilege to in participants, our very senior pediatrician, Dr. Deepak Shipri, sir, Dr. Usha Sharma, sir, Dr. Usha Sharma, ma'am, Dr. Kandar, and Dr. Rajiv Mansal is there. Oh. So first of all, I would like to request Dr. Sanjeev Uza Boss for expert comment. Dr. Uja. Dr. Sanjeev Uja Boss, are you there?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me? Yes, sir. Okay. Sir, thank you for a very brilliant presentation. In fact, you spoke so well in such a simple to understand format. It had some very nice practical take-home messages and some things which we can very easily apply in our day-to-day practices. I had one question actually, if I may be allowed to do so. You suggested that you can give bilastine up to 4 times the normal dose that is prescribed. So is that safe? And if it is safe, are there any side effects when they are used in such a high dose?
Okay, thank you for that question, especially regarding bilastine. Now I want to tell you about bilastine. Is I am an allergist dealing with pediatricians, pediatric patients and as well as adults. So till now we are using it about 12 years of age. Now the syrup which has come is to be used, not to be used below 6 years of age. Okay, it should be used above 6 years of age. You cannot use bilastine, is not recommended below 6 years of age. That's the first thing. Now, what the normal dose is, just it will be 10 mg, that is 5 ml. So four times the dose will be, okay, will be 40 ml. It's, in a case of it's acute, in a case of chronic urticaria, uncontrolled, you can, YAKI recommends, you can go to, that is the European Academy of Allergy and Clinical Immunology. As per the guidelines, you can go to four times the dose and you are absolutely safe. Don't have to worry about anything.
Okay, thank you so much.
Now, so sir, we have some question. First of all, I will start with the first case. In first case, you have to show the investigation of the different aeroallergen as well as food allergy allergen. And there is a, definitely this patient has allergy, rhinoconjunctivitis with severe eczema with moderate to severe asthma. Then when we see the case, after seeing the investigation, we have seen the so many food allergen is present, and you rightly mentioned that allergy level is more than 100. So this is, but in case, as you saw in the case, a milk has the positive more than 100, but if the child has taken the milk and there is no clinical symptoms, so can we think about that or we leave it? First okay. question.
Now, the very good point. Now, more than, see, they say that more than 100 is, you can get a rare case where it will be more than 100 and you may not get any reaction to milk, okay? But in this child who is, in which the milk is more than 100, you should challenge with milk in a hospital setting. You got it? If that is also okay, he can freely drink milk. But he has to be challenged with milk in a hospital setting. And now coming back, if the child is with more than 100 and he's taking milk and he's okay, then you can continue. But it's very unlikely.
Right. Sir, now my second question is that it is the, what is the common food component which is cross-reactive? Like that, which is common food reaction, that means is the shrimp is positive in a case, but the child is totally vegetarian. Is it any importance for that?
Yes, you have a point out there. They are the I can't get that chemical name. Okay, it starts with T. Okay, there's a cross reactivity between shrimps, prawns, and your dust mites. Okay, and cockroach also. So if you're allergic to because you're allergic to cockroach, you're allergic to dust mites, you can get a positive for shrimps and prawns.
Nay, sir, I understand your point. So shrimp cross-reactive with the dust mite as well as cockroach. But is it any food item that is cross-react, or what is the most common food item that is cross-react?
Okay, good. That's this one. The what you have is this banana. You have this bananas and apples and all, which will cross-react with certain pollens. Okay. So which will lead to a condition known as oral allergy syndrome. Okay. That is what it is. So because of allergy to a particular pollen, I cannot get the names, they're not specific, which you will get allergy to banana, you may get allergy to apple, okay, and certain food like avocados and maybe also latex. Okay, and when you eat these food items, okay, because it is the labile allergens which are positive, when you eat this food item in an uncooked manner, you might get a reaction. You will get a reaction. But if the same food is cooked, so the labile allergens will get destroyed. And since they get destroyed, you can eat that food freely. And this, the child will outgrow this allergy over a period of time. Okay, that is a very important thing. It's a very temporary thing because there are two types of allergens, labile allergens and stable allergens. All these cross-reactive allergens, like you know, as I mentioned about this pollen, they are, most of them are labile allergens, and the child will outgrow and will never develop anaphylaxis. Usually, do not develop anaphylaxis.
Sir, my next question, then I will put our chairperson for. I have so many multiple questions. My last question for this case, sir. When we in a very funding situation, when we order so many food allergy testing. Then in our case also, but but as you said, it is a no clinical correlation with these tests. So how we communicate the parents after getting the reports, that the child is positive, so many things, so many food allergens, but you communicate the parents, then you will continue that. So what is the importance of allergy test?
Yes. Yeah, very good question, Dr. Gupta. First thing I want to let you know is that this test should be done by the FEIA method, which was mentioned over there, fluorescent enzyme immunoassay. You know, we have this so many fake type of labs. I would like to take the names also, Gerard lab and Anjana labs and all.
Right, sir.
Please avoid doing tests from these fake labs. The method is very important. FEIA method, you should get it done. If it comes positive, then you have to explain to the mother, look, a cutoff level above a certain level, that is more than 100, is important. Baby says allergy. For all these which is positive, if your child is eating well, okay, and you have to correlate with the total IgE. Usually the total IgE will also be raised, okay? So because your total IgE is raised, these levels are being falsely raised. So don't worry about it, okay? That's all you have to tell her. Because why was that specific IgE raised in those patients? Because the total IgE is also markedly raised. So this is the false raise in the specific IgE. So if the child is tolerating it, he has to continue. So then she asks, will my child develop allergy to this in the future? Yes, you can develop allergy to those particular food item which is positive now, but no showing no clinical reactivity. There's a big possibility, but doesn't mean that you should stop it. They have to continue it, okay, in the cooked form.
Yes, sir. Sir, is it any correlation, any condition when the total IgE is normal and the so many polys and allergen, including the food, including aero allergen is positive and total IgE is the normal?
Yeah, no, that's also a very good question. Okay, you've been really been like a lawyer, been really cross-questioning me, okay? Now, this total IgE, well, let me get into this business. In this case, we did a total IgE, which was markedly raised. And why was the total IgE markedly raised? Because this child had this severe type of eczema, severe, and that is why all these patients with severe type of eczemas and all will have their total IgE raised, because all these allergens are entering the body and raising it. Now, if it is pure respiratory allergies most of the time, you can have, like the other case which I showed you, Yash, okay? I have not shown you the results. That child had a normal IgE. So the normal total IgE. So the total IgE is actually, in cases, especially in cases of your non-atopic patients, doesn't have importance, because you could have a severe respiratory allergy and a normal IgE. This is what, almost in 40% of cases, severe respiratory allergies, where you have a positive dust mite test or a positive fungal or a positive animal dander, and your total IgE may be normal in 40% of the cases. So I would never advocate doing total IgE in cases of these respiratory allergies.
Yeah, that's why I am asking this question. Sir, you have so long experience in your field. So in your practice, in eczema cases, the most culprit is food or aero allergen?
Now, this is also a very good question. The allergen, whether the food allergen or the aero allergen, is not the cause of eczema. Get that thing very clear.
Right, sir.
It's not the cause of eczema. The food allergen or aero allergen will only aggravate the eczema. This point should be very clear. Okay, you think, don't tell the parents that, oh, you have got this positive, and once you stop this, your eczema will go away. No, that particular food item is only aggravating. The eczema has a non-IgE mechanism also. Okay, it is mainly a non-IgE, because of which antihistamines do not work out there. Okay, so to answer your question
for skin allergy, most culprit, either food allergy, food particle versus aero allergen.
Okay, in almost all cases of eczema, you will get dust mites positive.
Definitely.
I'm telling you. Okay, you'll get dust mites positive. Right. But So you actually you should have a good well controlled dust mite that will bring about some improvement and all in the this one, especially if there are respiratory allergies. Okay, now so that's what. But among the food items, the three items you have to think of is milk, egg, and nuts. These are the three items which can cause, and fish.
Sir, audio is not clear.
Before going to the more question from audience, I will request our chairperson, Dr. Rathudi sir and Dr. Sharda sir, please put your comments and question, please. Rathudi sir.
Well, Dr. Ahmed, I'm really grateful for your such a excellent presentation. My personal question would be that what's the difference between Fadiatop and the RAST test?
Yeah, that's again a very good question. Is what is the difference between this Fadiatop and the RAST? Fadiatop is a what you call is like your it's augmenting. Okay, it's a brand of a Swedish company. Okay, the method is important. It's a RAST method, RAST, radio the immunoassay method, and the other is this FEIA method. Okay, which is the latest method. And what is Fadiatop is the brand of the Swedish company Thermo Fisher. Okay, there are two different methods. Nobody in the West now does RAST. Okay, one is because you use radioisotopes and it is not reliable. What is the reliable method for food allergens is this method of FEIA method. Now the branding of which they have done is that ImmunoCAP is a brand, or you can say the Fadiatop is the company or the brand. Okay, so is all three are is the same almost, FEIA, Fadiatop, or ImmunoCAP. Is the same, but you should never get your testing done by RAST method. That is the basic point I want to emphasize here. No RAST, either Fadiatop or your FEIA method, which is the same. Fadiatop is only a brand.
Sir, what is difference between the Fadiatop or ImmunoCAP or RAST? Please clear for our audience.
Now, RAST is that old radio absorbent
sorbent
test. Okay, radio absorbent test. That is the old standard method. Okay, I don't want to get into the technical details of it, which is outdated now. Nobody is doing RAST.
Right.
Okay, and which all these laboratories which are coming up and all with this fake one, they are doing RAST, and that's why the cost is so low, but it is not reliable. What you should do is by this FEI method. You get it done at any lab, but the method should be FEIA method, fluorescent enzyme immunoassay.
So okay, that is ImmunoCAP is the FEI?
Yes, ImmunoCAP is FEI method.
That Sanjeev, for yes, all sir. Pediatrician friends, this ImmunoCAP or the Fadiatop machine is available in J.K. Lawn Hospital, and we are doing it at a very bare minimum cost in the government setup. To get it done, we have this machine. This has costed us nearly about a crore rupees approximately, but the government has procured it and we are getting it done. Sir,
excellent.
This is great news.
I think you have enough one-to-one discussion with Sanjeev, which is almost like a class of teacher and student. So let me put in my nose into it. One thing
as and put your whole self into it.
One thing as an intensivist, I just last time also I had a talk about this thing. Most of our pediatrician, the general pediatrician as well, the specialty pediatrician, we don't keep adrenaline in our clinic setup. The adrenaline which comes in the supply or with the pharma companies have a very short expiry date. If we check it, it has a very short expiry date. And the last, but the worst thing is that EpiPen is not available in our country. So in this scenario, because we all of us have seen so many drug allergies, food allergies, especially notorious drugs, amoxicillin and all these things causing drug allergies. So I think we should have a protocol which everybody should have in their clinic to how to deal with. Because in your last case, this girl who recovered and then again collapsed, that was the secondary wave of anaphylaxis which the child was facing. So most of us, usually once the first wave is over, we tend to discharge them and we think that the allergy is over. But this time these things do happen. So availability of EpiPen not available, availability of adrenaline, and a ready reckoner for how to give IM adrenaline in if EpiPen is not available. This message should be clear, loud and clear to all treating pediatricians, that how we use adrenaline, because that is the life saving. So this is one thing. Secondly, what is the use of measuring tryptase enzyme? Is it because most of the time the allergies are apparent? Do we use tryptase for an established allergy, or when we use a tryptase assay only when we are confused whether this is sepsis or whether this is allergy?
Okay, good questions, Dr. Manish. Now the first question about adrenaline, you have brought the point home very well. Now it EpiPen is out of question in our country. Okay, so everybody has to have that adrenaline ampoule, which costs about 15 rupees, but has a very short life of 1 year. But the thing is, since it is very labile, you cannot keep it loaded. So now we have the new method is, you know, you load it and you keep it in that in a dark pen box, not more than a month or so. Okay, and then keep changing it repeatedly. That's what, because I know when I was working in a government hospital in Mumbai, KEM, we used to have this loaded one, and every day the nurse would change the adrenaline. So in your hospital, since it's a busy hospital, you should keep changing, have it loaded and keep changing every day. I think so. It doesn't cost more than 13, 15 rupees. But in a private setup, they can load it and keep it in the box. And that's what I tell my patients who have had an episode of anaphylaxis, that you keep the adrenaline, and one way is to keep it loaded in a spectacle box and keep changing it every month. Now, your second question was about this tryptase. Now, tryptase is the diagnosis. First point is the diagnosis of anaphylaxis is strictly clinical. Okay. Number two, tryptase has not much value when for oral allergen, like food anaphylaxis. It has a value for injectable, like an insect bite or an injection. Now what happens, and this is, I'll tell you two case. In my clinic, you are given ceftriaxone on the third day and the patient collapsed, okay? And they started blaming us, okay? So what we did was, we admitted this patient and we collected the blood for tryptase within 6 hours, and it was normal. Now, what was the reason? And therefore, we showed that was not anaphylaxis, and it was not the cause for the drug was not the cause for the child collapsing. What was the cause? Why did the child collapse? The girl collapse? It was because of a vasovagal episode. Okay, so sometimes it can help you out, okay, to disprove that your injection was the cause for that particular reaction. So it can have be of some medical legal value, where if there's an increase in the tryptase level, you can say it was a case of anaphylaxis. And if it is normal, then you can say that was not anaphylaxis. Because how do you prove it in a court of law that it is on what you saw clinically? Am I right?
Right, okay. Sir. Right. Sir, one question from our senior pediatrician, Dr. Sethi, has asked, which antihistaminic is best for acute urticaria, and how many days, as relapse is very common, and as any investigation for relapse?
Okay, that's also now. Let me put this one point very, very, very clear. The treatment of urticaria, whether acute or chronic urticaria, is second generation antihistaminics, that is bilastine, your fexofenadine, elaspan, and cetirizine. Okay, these are the standard drugs which should be used. But when a child comes with acute urticaria with the swelling of the lips and all, and this, then this drug, along with the second generation antihistaminics, which you're going to keep this child on, you should also give for quick control a short acting first generation antihistaminics like chlorpheniramine or hydroxyzine, like your Atarax.
Sir, what how many days we continue as relapse is very common.
Yeah, the second generation antihistamines can be continued for 10 days, okay, and then you stop it. Well, this first generation should be given for maximum 3 to 5 days, very for a short period of time to bring it. Yes.
Any investigation for recurrent relapse in urticaria.
Yes. So for acute urticaria, you look for all the common causes. You look for worm infestations. You look for urine infections. You look for viral infections. It could be a presentation of a liver problem. It could be a presentation of a thyroid problem or some GI problem. So it has to be completely investigated. And do not think just purely about allergy.
And our second chairperson, Dr. Sharda, has question. Dr. Sharda, sir, please you ask your question. Dr. Sharda, sir. Sharda, sir, are you here?
Sanjeev, you ask.
Second chairperson, Dr. Sharda, has asked, do we need any injectable antihistaminic in emergency room for management of anaphylaxis apart from the hydrocortisone or adrenaline?
Yeah.
Apart from
now this point, I want to make it very clear. All these other things, intravenous steroids, intravenous chlorpheniramine, IM chlorpheniramine, or your IV fluids, all have a secondary effect. Okay. The main thing is IM adrenaline. Okay. All the others are supportive. They have a supportive role, but the main thing is giving adrenaline, because adrenaline stores are replenished, and unless and are lost, are depleted. So unless and until you replenish the adrenaline stores by giving IM adrenaline, this child may not come out.
Sir, in a newborn baby, which moisturizer is the best? As so many parents have asked about the moisturizer, we directly say that you apply the moisturizer. So which moisturizer is best, content-wise?
Okay. Now, as far as the moisturizers, without getting into brands, see, the most important, like that child which I showed you, Ashna, the patient who had a severe allergy, atopic dermatitis, what you should use is paraffin gel. That's the paraffin gel is the best, because it has no chemicals, no additives, nothing. So that's now going back. You cannot apply paraffin gel in a newborn baby, okay, in an infant. You can use the coconut oil is good, but if you want to apply a moisturizer, use a moisturizer with as least chemicals and additives and preservatives as possible. That's all I can say without getting into brands.
Manish sir, would you like to ask anything?
No, I think before we already have a question, and you have grilled sir too much. I think let us allow him to have dinner and some other time you can grill him. Sir, you must be happy that we have good allergy specialist.
Oh, I'm really been really foxed by many of the questions. I'm really glad, and I really enjoyed myself thoroughly today.
No, sir, that was a wonderful presentation, and your knowledge. I mean, you are so full of knowledge that the way you have given the answers justifies your knowledge and your depth of knowledge.
But that's why I would request everybody to read this book.
Sure, sir. Sure. Before I give to Sanjeev, sir, it's my moral duty to give a big thanks to Vigon people. These people have been standing with us since last 5 weeks, and they have promised us to keep on be on our side for providing these webinars. Thank you so much, Chandramohan, who is one of the team leaders for the Vigon. And we are thank you, Vigon India.
Very thankful on behalf of Jaipur IAP. We have continuous, this is our 7th webinar, every Saturday, 8:30 to 9:30 p.m. with the eminent speaker from national and international repute. And I'm very thankful to our chairperson, Dr. Rathudi sir, very eminent, our mentor, our guide, and Dr. Sharda sir. We are very thankful to my senior, my pathway, Dr. Manish Sarva sir, my mentor, Dr. R.K. Gupta sir, and in participants, we have very, very senior pediatrician, Dr. Rajiv Bansal sir, Dr. Kamdar sir, Usha ma'am, and Dr. Shivpuri sir. Thank you once again, Dr. R.F. Ahmed sir, for giving, for sparing the time. We are very thankful. We are very thankful. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Good night. God bless you all.
Again, again, we will meet on next Saturday evening, same time, 8:30 to 9:30. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you, everybody.